Blackstone Publishing presents Squadron Airborne by Elleston Trevor. This book is read by Andrew Fallaize. 1. For a long time now, there had been nothing but the starlight and the silence and the mist. There had been no wind in the night and no moon. The mist had come soon after sundown yesterday, and it still lay across the aerodrome so that the hangars and other buildings were still hidden from the air. Camouflage as perfect as this would have taken several hundred men to construct and spread out, and several hundred more to draw away and fold up in the morning. And even then, it would not have had the quality of this strange dawn ghostliness. Over the minutes, the east sky was becoming brushed with faint light, and the stars were losing theirs. The mist lingered, because there was no warmth yet. The light from the east began flushing through its haze, and other lights now moved in slow Indian file, feeble yellow lights as small as eyes. They were the lamps of vans and bicycles, trying to show the perimeter road as the ground crews came down to dispersals. The mist muffled most sounds, but here and there a man called something to another. A van bumped over grass, a tailboard dropped. More light came, in thin cracks patterning the dark, as lamps were switched on in the flight offices and crew rooms, gleaming out through the gaps of blackout curtains. Later, peewits began calling from the flat land beyond the airfield. The first bus went throbbing, hardly seen, along the road past B Flight, taking workmen to the chemical factory in Melford. Later still, when the sky to the east was awash in saffron, the mist started to tear slowly so that patches revealed the corner of a hangar, the windows of the control tower, the idle windsock. An aircraft took shape by degrees, its photograph slowly developed by the strengthening light. Its outline, still to be filled in, might have been the outline of any object with gaunt angles protruding, meaningless angles that had nothing yet to do with a tail fin or an undercarriage or a propeller. The machine, no more gainly than a group of fallen tree trunks and cold right through from the long disuse of the night, looked no more likely to rise into the air than dead timber. But a man came across to it from the dispersal huts and stooped below the long shape of it, unhooking the elastic cords of the covers, pulling them clear and folding them, dumping them on the grass. As he swung up onto the wing and slid back the cockpit hood, another man came across pulling a trolley ack, his breath clouding in the faint light. He uncoiled the thick black snake of the lead, plugging it in, drawing the trolley back below the wing. He ducked again, kicking the chocks tight against the flat black tyres, and came back to the trolley and waited, cupping his hands and blowing into them. The strengthening light touched their skin with pink, turning them raw. The man in the cockpit unlocked the controls. The metal was cold to the touch. He threw the locking struts out, and the man on the ground picked them up. The priming pump pressed fuel along the pipes with a syringe sound. He screwed the knob tight, flicked the mag switches on, drew the control column back against his chest, and pressed the starter button.
Okay. Right. Yep.
The man by the trolley ack put his thumb on the button and pressed. The propeller moved suddenly, its gears banging through the backlash, the starter motor making a thin discord of music under the cowlings. A cylinder fired, the blade spun through a half circle, and then the gears banged again, sending a shudder through the length of the aircraft. The man in the cockpit used the primer again. The propeller went on turning, its three blades swinging slowly, then suddenly they became invisible, as the engine fired on all 12 and blue gas exploded from the exhaust stubs, whipping away in the slipstream. The man on the ground called something, but the word was lost in the beat of sound. He doubled under the wing, yanking the starter lead out, taking the trolley ack clear. The leading aircraftman at the controls drew the hood shut and set the warming up revs and pulled a paperback novel out of his overalls, opening it at the page where he had dog-eared it. With more noise beating round him than 100 voices could ever make, he began to read, undisturbed. Other machines, dispersed somewhere in the desert of the mist, were being started up. The sun was clearing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.